What's up, game developers? CouchFerret here. Welcome back to yet another video of making awesome games in Unity. Today we'll talk about respawning archers. We'll do it in a special way to avoid spawn camping that we all hate in games for sure. Roll the intro. Before we jump into it, I'm happy to announce that the CouchFerret Discord server is up and running and waiting for you to join. On the server, you'll find a lot of like-minded game developers. You can join the server with this link, which is also in the description. And another big announcement is that I've set up my Patreon page where you can get all the sprites, project files, and so much more while supporting me. Go check it out, the link is in the description. Also, big thanks to all of my current supporters for being the very first and helping me make more videos. Thank you guys. Let's jump into Unity. It's time to upgrade our Unity. Though it's recommended to upgrade when you can, but if you're deep in a project, think twice before upgrading. An upgrade, especially a major upgrade like this, can break a lot of things in your game. On major upgrade, I mean if the first part of the version number has changed. So for example, this project is currently using Unity 2018.something.something and we want to upgrade it to Unity 2019.something.something. But let's break this down to parts. Most software companies use a thing called semantic versioning when they come up with their version numbers. You shouldn't worry much about the details, but you should know what each change means in the different parts. On the Semantic Versioning's website, it says that a given version number looks like this. Major, minor, and patch. And as a software developer, for example, if you were Unity the company, you should increment the major version when you make incompatible API changes. In this case, it means that when we upgrade our Unity from 2018 to 2019, we should expect a few things to break in our game. For example, the animator in the 2019's version could be significantly different than it was before, so all of our codes that use the animator could potentially break, but all of this is just theoretical. You should increment the minor version when you add functionality in a backward compatible manner. This means that you should be safe upgrading your project, for example from 2018.1 to 2018.2. And you should increment the patch version when you make backwards compatible bug fixes. So when patch changes, you shouldn't worry about much. However, all of this is just versioning guidelines and not strict rules. Always make a backup or a copy of your project before you hit upgrade. With all of this in mind, we are ready to expect the worst. We are upgrading from 2018.3.6 to 2019.1.10. It's a major upgrade, so we are pretty much doomed. As we've expected, there are a bunch of red errors in the console. If something like this happens, you should make a quick Google search on it. I've already done the search and I've found the fix. The .NET scripting runtime 3.5 that the project uses became deprecated and the TextMesh Pro package is already trying to use the newer 4.x. So if we go to Edit, Project Settings, Player, Other, and we change the scripting runtime version to 4.x, then all of our errors should go away. Though, it requires a Unity restart. Voila! We don't have errors anymore. Okay, in the last video we left off with hit detection, where the arrows print out a message of their hits. We'll take this further by making the archers respawn when they get hit by an arrow. To make the respawn mechanism, first we need spawn points. These points will mark the locations where the archers can respawn. Let's create an empty game object and name it spawn point and reset its transform. To make it visible in the scene view, let's set its icon to a blue circle and make sure to have the gizmos turn on. We don't need any additional components or scripts on it, because we only use the positions of these spawn points. Before making a few copies of it, let's make it into a prefab so we can change the spawn points together later. It's enough to just drag and drop it into the project window. In fact, it turns out that Unity has removed prefabs from the Create menu in version 2019. So from now on, you can only create them by dragging them into the project window. Anyway, let's create a few spawn point instances by hitting Command D or Control D and let's move them around to our taste. Okay, that's enough for now and we should group them so they don't clutter the hierarchy window. I'll just drag them under an empty game object. That's much better. Currently we have two scripts, a player controller and an arrow script. The thing is that none of these scripts should respawn archers. I mean, they could, especially the player controller script, but it would be messy to have them contain spawn logic. What we'll do instead is to create a new game object and a new script on it to implement all the game related logics. I'm gonna create an empty game object and name it game logic. Let's add a new component to it, and we can call that component game logic as well. This will create the new component's C# script. Let's move it into the scripts folder and open it up. I'm gonna define a new public function and call it spawnArcher. In this function, we'll find the perfect spawn position for the given archer and spawn him there. But first, let's call this function from the arrow script when an arrow hits an archer. Here, we don't have a reference for the GameLogic object, and that's a problem. And if I define a public variable for it, it won't work. It doesn't matter how I'm trying to assign the variable's value to the GameLogic object, Unity won't let it be assigned. The problem is that the arrow is a prefab and the GameLogic is a scene game object. So let's remove the variable that we've created. Unity doesn't allow us to have a prefab reference a game object in a scene, because scene objects come and go when you restart a scene. So we need to create this reference during runtime. First, let's find the GameLogic game object with the GameObject.Find function, which finds objects by their names. We need to give the function the given game object's name as its argument, so I'm gonna write GameLogic into its parentheses. But if I try to access the spawnArcher function on this game object, it won't work. Even the script editor won't list it. That's because we only have the game object in our hands instead of the component, which is on the game object. We have to use the GetComponent function to get the component, and that's the one that has the spawnArcher function. This GetComponent function looks a bit strange because of its angle brackets before its parentheses. These angle brackets are there because the GetComponent function has a generic version. Generic functions are special because you can not only give them values when calling them, but you can also give them types as well. In this case, I'm giving the GameLogic as the type in the angle brackets, which refers to the GameLogic component or mono behavior we've created a few minutes ago. This makes the GetComponent function return a value with GameLogic type, and that will be our component. Finally, we can call the spawnArcher function on this, and let's remove the debug line below it. Let's try it out. Now when we shoot the other archer, we can see the debug lines from the spawnArcher function in the console window. Now let's jump back into the GameLogic script, and let's create a random spawn logic, which selects a spawn point randomly. I'm gonna define a new function for it and call it getRandomSpawnPoint. But to choose randomly from the spawn points, we need a list of the existing spawn points in the scene. We have to declare a GameObject array to have the references for all the spawn points. Okay, let's return a spawn point from the array. To do it randomly, we need to index a spawn point from the array randomly. We can do that with the random.range function, which returns a random integer between its first and second arguments. The tooltip says that the min value is inclusive, so we want to put a 0 in there, and the max value is exclusive, so we need to put the last spawn point's index in the array plus 1. And that's the length of the array, in other words, the number of spawn points in the array. Awesome! Let's not forget to drag and drop the spawn points into the GameLogic's array. To save some time, let's lock the inspector window so it won't change when we select other objects in the scene, and let's select all the spawn points and drag and drop them from the scene into the array variable's name, where we get that little green plus icon. This will add all the spawn points to the array, so we don't have to do it one by one. Finally, let's unlock the inspector window and move back to the script. Okay, finding an awesome spawn position is implemented, so let's replace the debug line with the actual function call. We need to save the return value of this function call, so we can use it later to spawn the archer. Instead of destroying the archer who got hit, we'll just change his position to the spawn point. This way we won't destroy and instantiate game objects unnecessarily, which can be quite resource expensive. To have a reference for the archer, let's add a new parameter to the spawnArcher function and call it archer. And because we've changed the function signature, we need to fix the function call in the arrow script. Let's pass the other variable as the argument, so the spawnArcher function gets a reference to the archer. By changing his strength from that position to the spawn point's strength from that position, we respawn the archer. Let's see if it works. Awesome, the archer respawns. As I promised, we will code a more sophisticated spawn mechanism that eliminates spawn camping. We'll do that by coming up with an algorithm that finds the furthest point from the other archers, so the respawned archer will have better chances to survive. I'll demonstrate it on a piece of packaging paper. Here's the level we have in the game, and here are all the spawn points and a few extra archers. Let's say that this archer dies here and we like to find a spawn point for him. To get the spawn point that is the furthest away from everybody, first we need to calculate each spawn point's distance from the nearest archer. So we need to go through all the spawn points. That's one for loop. Okay, let's focus on one spawn point for now and see what we have to do. We need to come up with a code that's calculating the distance between this spawn point and all of the archers. So to do that, we need to go through all of the archers and calculate the distance between the given archer and the spawn point, and we need to find the smallest distance value between these. This means another for loop in the existing one. To make the code look a bit simpler, we'll save all the spawn points' smallest distance in an array. It's like writing the final values of the distance calculations above the spawn points. This way, we can easily compare all of them and find the one that has the biggest number on it, which gives us the furthest spawn point from all of the archers. To compare them, we'll need a simple for loop next to and not in the other for loops. Cool, it's time to do the implementation. I'm gonna define a separate function for it called getFurtherSpawnPoint. First, we've talked about going through all the spawn points, so let's make a for loop for that. It's a simple for loop with a loop variable in it, which goes through all the existing indexes in the spawn points array. Inside this for loop, we can focus on the current spawn point. To calculate the distances between this spawn point and all of the archers, we need to go through the archers. So we'll need an inner for loop here, but first we have to define a variable that holds all the Archer game objects references, just like the array we made for the spawn points. Now we can go through this array with the for loop. Make sure to define this inner loop's loop variable with a different name. We usually name these I, J, K in order, and probably you will never need more than 3. Okay, let's calculate the distance between the spawn point and an archer. If we subtract the spawn point's position from the archer's position, we get a vector that represents the distance between the two. From this vector, we can easily get the actual distance by its magnitude property. However, in this case, when we only compare the distances, and we don't care about the actual distances themselves, it's wiser to use the square magnitude property instead. This square magnitude property holds the value of the magnitude's value, but squared. During the distance calculations, the computer first ends up with the square of the magnitude, and as the last step, it does a square root calculation on this value to get the actual distance. But a square root calculation is a pretty expensive one, so we tend to cheat it off and use the square magnitude instead. Let's save this value to a variable and call it square distance. To find the smallest square distance, first we need to create a variable that holds the current smallest value we calculated so far. Let's name it min, like minimum, and assign the mathf.infinity to it, because any square magnitude value will definitely be smaller than this. Inside the inner for loop, let's create an if statement that checks if a given square distance is smaller than the minimum, which is the current smallest square distance we got so far. If the square distance is smaller, then it means that we have an even smaller value, so we need to save this into the min variable. When the for loop went through all the archers, we'll have the nearest archer's square distance from the spawn point in the min variable. To make the code a bit simpler, I'm gonna save this smallest square distance value for each spawn point into an array. So let's define a new array called min square distances, and on the right side of the assignment, let's create a new float array with as many values in it as spawn points we have. To save the current spawn point's minimum square distance, we need to set the current floats value in the array to the min's value that we've calculated. Be careful where you place the assignment and which loop variable you use. It's pretty easy to mess it up. Now we know for each spawn point that how close they are to archers. We only need to find the furthest from the archers. It's a similar calculation than we had with the min variable, but now we are looking for the biggest value, the maximum. First, let's define a max variable to save the current biggest value and the max index variable so we'll know in the end which spawn point had the biggest value. I'm gonna set both of these to the first spawn point, so initially the max variable will be the first value in the min square distance, and the max index will be 0, the smallest index in the array. Let's iterate through the rest of the values in the array with the for loop, but in this case it's enough to start the I loop variable from 1, because we've already assumed that the current furthest spawn point is the first one. In this loop, we need to create an if statement where we check if the current square distance that we are at is bigger than the biggest one we found so far. If it is, we need to set both the max and the max index variables to this new biggest value and its index. When the for loop went through all the square distances, we'll know for sure which spawn point is actually the furthest from the archers. And to wrap up this complicated function, we need to return the spawn point itself. That was complicated, I hope I made sense. Now, if we change the function calling the spawnArcher function, then we can see how our awesome and overcomplicated logic works. And don't forget to drag the archers into the GameLogic's archers array. Awesome! Let's duplicate a few extra archers so they won't respawn at the same two spawn points. Nice. That's it for today, folks. Next time we'll talk about how to structure your code in Unity so it won't become a huge spaghetti. Stay tuned, be sure to subscribe and say hello to us on Discord. Huge thanks again to all the awesome Patreon supporters. See you next time!